Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the invitation. I feel very privileged to be amongst the tribe, as you call it. I can see that it's a big tribe, and you know, listening to the presentation, I can already feel the aura, you know, the sisterhood, the support, the encouragement. So it's a really an honor and a privilege to be here. So with me, it is evening time. It's almost 8:30 where I'm at. So as Ruth has already introduced, my name is Nondumiso. I'm Ndumie Myataza. I am from South Africa, so born and raised there, and I've had the privilege of traveling the country, staying in various places, meeting some awesome people, and just, you know, growing as a human being. So please allow me, I believe that this summit is now coming to an end. And, you know, as it's been concluded, please allow me to share my story. I think Christians would call it a testimony, but either way, it's a story, you know, with the hope that we will learn something and we would gain something from it. So I'd like to talk under a theme. I don't know whether the theme or the topic, but my message is, you know, embodied in this simple sentence, that when life seems to be not going according to your direction, trust me, it is then when it's going to the direction in which it was supposed to be going. You know, sometimes we have dreams, we have aspirations, and, you know, we've got goals, and we even set ourselves timelines that, you know, by this time, this is where I should be, this is what I should be doing with these people. And sometimes life does not necessarily give us that, and we get frustrated because we're like, you know, this is not how things were supposed to be. You know, this is not how my life was supposed to go. But trust me, you know, in the years that I've lived, I've witnessed that actually those curves and, you know, those distractions, so you would think, are actually there for a purpose. But before I proceed, let me just share my story and how I got to this conclusion. So I was raised, I was born into a couple. I'm a firstborn. You know, growing up very loved, growing in a couple that loved each other dearly. I think we were a power couple, or they were a power couple rather, you know, hashtag couple goals, where everyone, you know, aspired to be them. And I was privileged, you know, I felt very privileged that to have them as my parents. And I came from an environment or a community which had a lot of single parented homes. So, you know, my neighbors were single mothers. You know, most of my peers did not even know their fathers. And I was there to witness how that disadvantaged them in life, you know. And I felt very privileged, very blessed, you know. I saw, you know, the confidence that I had as this girl who had a mom and a dad who had this environment at home. Little did I know that that won't be the rest, or that's not how the story is going to end, right? So, the story is quite long, but to cut it short, when I was 15 years old, my parents got divorced. Actually, they separated, and the divorce was only finalized 2 years later when I was 17. So remember, you know, my home is where my whole confidence was built on. You know, that's who I knew myself to be. And I always say this, that with you would get that with some children, they would secretly want their parents to divorce because of the situation that, you know, the circumstances that they live under. But that was not, as I said, you know, my parents loved each other. They always portrayed, you know, it was a happy home, a loving home, a warm home. It was very homey, you know, where we got the attention we needed. And as I said, in an environment, in a community where, you know, a number of homes were impoverished, we got to go to decent schools, you know, great. I'm grateful for that. You know, we lived a decent life. And it was because, you know, my dad was the breadwinner, because my mom had now become a housewife. And, you know, so you can just imagine at the situation now when, you know, life is changing unexpectedly, you know, even in my wildest dreams. You know, if someone told my younger self that that's how life would have been, then I would have laughed, you know, in disbelief that no, that it's not my home that you are talking about. So I was in a state, you know, I was in a state. I always fail to find the right words to just describe, you know. At first, you know, that the whole cycles of grief, at first you deny it, you're like, no man, these people love each other, it's gonna be okay, they're going, you know, they're gonna realize that, you know, we actually, you know, were meant to be. But years go, and you know, as I said, the process of divorce took a full 2 years, and I was hoping somehow that within that 2 years they would, you know, they would come to their senses, so I thought. But we're here 12 years later, and my parents are, you know, they are divorced. And as I said, that, you know, I was a lot of things happened. You know, it was an ugly divorce. It hurt us, you know, emotionally, psychologically. As I said, I was a teenager, already battling with a lot of identity issues, a lot of self-esteem issues, because my body was changing, you know, the developments that we go through as ladies. And I did not receive this very well. And I think what really made the situation worse was the financial impacts that it hit my family so much. You know, as I said, we were decent, you know, we weren't rich, but we could afford, you know. I always say that as a kid, if I nagged enough, then I would get what I wanted, you know. But here I am now having to experience this life so badly that we had to change houses. You know, the house that we're in had to be sold, and we just had to adapt to a life that we never knew, you know, so much that we had to go and live in areas that we have never thought, you know, in neighborhoods that we never thought we'd ever stay in. And luckily, now that I think about it, luckily then, that I always had a hobby. You know, I've always loved poetry. I was once a librarian at my primary school, because I love books, I love words, I loved reading, and I always journaled, you know. So I would just take my journal and I would take my pen, especially on those really hard days where I'm like, I just can't, you know, when I'm too overwhelmed, where I'm in total disbelief, where exactly I feel like this is not the direction that life should go, you know, things are collapsing. And then I would take my pen, I would take my journal, and I would record them. And and this kept me very sane. You know, I got to a point where I was not comfortable, but much more accepting of the situation in which we were in. As a firstborn, you know, and I think especially in the African culture where you now have to take care of your family, you know, now you have to look after. So I got into terms with that, and I was determined, I was ambitious. I wrote down my dreams and what I wanted to achieve in life. And, you know, to cut the long story short, it is on those moments where my book was written. So now I stand as an author because of that situation. You know, as I said, I've always loved words. I've always knew that I might end up, in as much as I did not necessarily study literature or anything, but because of my love for words, I always knew that I would somehow be an author. But I always thought it would be much later in life. But little did I know that the very same experience of my parents' divorce, the very same experience when I thought my life was coming to an end, it is in that moment that I had to be in that position, because we all know the stats of divorce nowadays. And I, through that opportunity, I thankfully got an opportunity of being a big sister. You know, I'm a firstborn at home, and I've got an opportunity of being able to extend, you know, my, as we're talking about sisterhood, to extend that part of myself to a lot of other, not just girls, but, you know, a lot of other children who are devastated about, you know, the state of what their homes have turned out to be. So little did I know that, you know, with all of that, I will actually get to be some sort of an ambassador, that I will be the one who reminds children such as myself that it's okay. You know, you don't have to commit suicide. You don't have to indulge into self-harm activities. You can actually rise. You can actually be a better person because of the experiences. And, you know, to me, unfortunately, it had to be the divorce of my parents. But we all get hurdles along the way. To some, it's losing parents, you know. And I think I also got to that point where I got to be grateful that, you know what, my parents are still both alive, regardless of the change, but they are still alive, and I can still access their love. I can still access their care. Yes, things will change a bit. You know, we will have to adapt a bit into this new way of life. But, you know, so through that process, I also got to be grateful. And that's not the only hurdle that life has given, you know, but it has put me in a position of gratitude that whatever happens, no matter how ugly, because I think I had to go through that process, because I thought it was the worst thing that could happen, and life threw the worst thing that I thought could happen. And life also showed me that, hey, you're actually stronger than what you think. So in summary, you know, that's the message that I've got my book right here that I try to emanate through this book, but also through platforms such as this, through conversations, you know, in bus stations, in trains, that because especially with the pandemic, which is what then led me to be a blogger, because, you know, there was a time where we just received negativity, and we all thought that, you know, life is going in a direction in which it shouldn't. It's like life is getting lost. You know, this is not how things are supposed to be. But then I then had that idea of actually tapping into my experience and reminding people on a weekly, it started weekly, it was bi-weekly, and now it's monthly, that, you know what, just when we think life is not going well, it is in those moments, because in those moments we get to realize that we are actually stronger than what we are, than what we actually perceive ourselves, and we get lessons that enable us and empower us, because there's a long journey ahead, you know. So we always get these little nuggets of lessons, and these nuggets of strength along the way. So two things I would like to say, you know, based on what I've just said, that do not panic. I know, whether it's in your business, whether it's in your marriage, but trust the process. Whether it's your kids, you know, we get challenged in many different ways, but trust the process. Unfortunately, we don't have, you know, a peak of tomorrow, but whatever happens today is definitely happening to make us better people for tomorrow. Thank you very much.